Maundy Thursday service as we remember our Lord for the time when he instituted that sacrament, Holy Communion, wherein he gives us his own body and blood. We begin our printed order of service with the opening sentences. The Lord Almighty grant us a quiet night and peace at the last.
Amen.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord.
To sing praise to your name, O Most High.
To herald your love in the morning.
Your truth at the close of the day.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Thank you.
5. O Lord, open my lips,
and my mouth shall declare your praise.
Hasten to save me, O God.
O Lord, come quickly to help me.
Dearly beloved, as we intend to come to the supper of our Lord, let us humbly confess our sins and our need of God's forgiveness. Eternal Father, I confess that I have wandered far from your will, yet by your grace and sustained by your fatherly heart, forgive my sins of neglect, waste, impurity, rebellion, and selfishness. I deserve only your wrath, but earnestly desire your forgiveness, that I may be your faithful servant. In mercy, welcome me as your child. Receive me on the merits of the innocent suffering and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ.
By the grace of our waiting Father, ever ready to forgive, and in the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord God, you have brought us safely to this hour of evening prayer. We thank you for providing all that we need for body and life. Bless us who have gathered in your name. Forgive our sins. Speak to our hearts. Dispel our sorrows with the comfort of your word, and receive our hymns of thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, our living Savior, who reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Congregation, may be seated.
Thank you.
The Old Testament reading for this evening and the basis for our sermon this night comes from Zechariah chapter 1, beginning with verse 5. Then the angel of the Lord said, O Lord of hosts, how long will you have no mercy on Jerusalem and the cities of Judah, against which you have been angry these 70 years? And the Lord answered graciously, and comforting words came from the angel who talked with me. So the angel who talked with me said to me, cry out, thus says the Lord of hosts, I am exceedingly jealous for Jerusalem and for Zion, and I am exceedingly angry with the nations that are at ease, for which I was angry but a little, then furthered the disaster. Therefore, thus says the Lord, I have returned to Jerusalem with mercy. My house shall be built in it, declares the Lord of hosts, and the measuring line shall be stretched out over Jerusalem. Cry out again, thus says the Lord of hosts, my cities shall again overflow with prosperity, and the Lord will again comfort Zion, and again choose Jerusalem. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson comes from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 10, beginning with verse 16, where Paul writes, is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. Consider the people of Israel. Do not those who eat the sacrifices participate in the altar? Do I mean then that a sacrifice offered to an idol is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, but the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. And I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons too. You cannot have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with the psalmody and the psalm of prayer as printed in your service folder. I will lift up the cup of salvation
and call on the name of the Lord.
How can I repay the Lord for all his goodness to me?
I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints.
O Lord, truly I am your servant.
I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have freed me from my chains.
I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord.
I will lift up the cup of salvation
and call on the name of the Lord.
God of mercy and might, through the resurrection of your Son, you freed us from the anguish of guilt and the bonds of death. Be with us on our pilgrimage, and help us glorify you in the presence of all your people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us rise in honor of our Lord for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Gospel for Maundy Thursday comes from Luke chapter 22, beginning with verse 7. Then came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover. Where do you want us to prepare for it? They asked. He replied, as you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room, all furnished. Make preparations there. They left and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Here ends our gospel lesson. You may be seated as we continue with our sermon hymn. Please note we'll sing the first four verses of hymn 634. Enters the temple earlier in Holy Week. Zeal overtakes him. He cleanses the temple of the money changers and others who are profiteering from the Lord's gift of the Passover sacrifice. Christ's passionate fervor is again on display when he curses a fig tree. His passion is not in doubt when he debates in the temple, when he silences his opponents. Christ passionately speaks woes against the scribes and the Pharisees. With overwhelming intensity, Christ laments, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophet and stones those who are sent to it. How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you are not willing." Passion, fervor, is found in Jesus' words from the Mount of Olives, when he describes the coming destruction of Jerusalem and the glory of his impending return on the last day. Jesus passionately defends the woman in Bethany who anoints his feet with oil. So this certainly is a passionate week. And it all comes to a head tonight. Jesus longs for this night. He longs for this meal with his disciples. Ever since his conception in the womb of Mary, Jesus has been in the state of humiliation. That means, from our confirmation days, that he is true God, with full access to his divine power, but he has not been using it fully at all times. At his resurrection, he will then pass to the state of exaltation for the rest of eternity. He will fully use his divine power for your blessing and your benefit, but on Holy Thursday, he still holds back that power. In that state, he suffers as every human being suffers. Throughout his life, Jesus knew hunger. He knew pain. He knew what it was like to be oppressed, not just physically, but in every other way. That's where he is on this particular night. He's already exhausted, even as the fullness of his passion, the suffering, the wrath of God against our sin is still yet to come. And with all this pressing upon him, Jesus is emotionally spent. It's no wonder he's been longing for this Last Supper with his disciples. He needs this night to rejoice in the Passover, to be strengthened by the presence of his disciples, and to remember the Lord's gracious salvation of his people in Egypt so that he might have strength as he brings about a far greater salvation in the hours yet to come. This night is of the highest benefit for Christ's disciples, of course, for us, as he institutes his supper, so that they and us can receive his body and blood for the forgiveness of sins, for life, for salvation. And so this night is of the highest benefit for you. The supper and its blessings are yours. But Christ needs this night as well. He longs for this night. You could even say that Jesus is jealous for this night. And you are blessed by Christ's jealousy. Zechariah chronicles how the Lord sent his angel to deliver gracious and comforting words to the prophet. Those words are for you also. And among those words of grace and comfort are these. The Lord says, "I am exceedingly jealous for Jerusalem and for Zion." Jesus is jealous for his people. It is the passion that Jesus showed throughout Holy Week, including his call. "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem." You are blessed by that jealousy because you are part of Jerusalem. You are part of Zion. Jerusalem is shorthand for the people of God. Zion is shorthand for the temple that stood upon Mount Zion, the temple where God promised to dwell among his people in grace and mercy. The Lord, Christ himself, is jealous for his people, for he longs to dwell among them with grace and mercy. Jesus is jealous. That may carry a bit of shock back, I think. But you've heard it before. I mean, remember in the close of the commandments in your catechism? Goes back to Exodus chapter 20 when God says, I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. You were likely taught, like I was, not to be jealous. I remember my mom taught me that. She was using the word jealous as probably another word for like coveting. You know, right in line with the 9th and 10th commandments. That's the common English usage. Jealous is when you desire something that belongs to someone else. Scripture, however, uses jealousy a bit differently. You are jealous when you desire to keep what rightfully belongs to you. Oh, there are times when we want to keep our stuff due to sinful moments. We don't want to share with anybody. But desiring to keep what is rightfully yours is also driven by holy love. A husband who finds another man flirting with his wife is rightfully jealous. Christ is rightfully jealous when some false god flirts with Jerusalem, his bride, his church. When a child is kidnapped, her parents rightfully are stirred to holy jealousy, we might say. The child belongs with them. It's not that they're being selfish. They're driven by love for their child. They refuse to share their child with another because they want to provide for that child, to love her, to meet her needs, to shelter and cherish her. That is the jealousy that Christ has for you. He will not share you with some idol that tries to capture your heart or that would kidnap you. Christ knows that every idol will fail you. Whatever idol you chase after, money, power, popularity, fame, excitement, each of them will not be able to follow through on whatever promises they've made. Most of all, they will not deliver life to you. They'll do just the opposite. They'll rob you of life. That's why Jesus is jealous. He will not share you with idols that fail you and take life from you. Christ's jealousy is pure gospel. His jealousy drives the Lord to determine. In verse 16 of our text, we read, thus says the Lord, I have returned to Jerusalem with mercy. Zechariah saw fulfillment of these blessed words in his own day. The temple was rebuilt in order that the Lord might dwell among his people, delivering forgiveness, mercy, grace. Zechariah had reason to rejoice. You and I, however, have even greater reason to rejoice. This week commemorates when our Lord returned to Jerusalem in humiliation, passionately ready to suffer for your salvation. The Lord returns to us. For weeks now, in the Lenten season, we have been hearing the repeated call of the Lord, return to me. His call was driven by jealousy. He longs for his people so that he might gather them as a hen gathers her chicks. The Lord intensely desires to recline at table with every one of his beloved people so that he might have fellowship with you and that he might meet your needs. Return to the Lord. It's a passionate call of love. And now the Lord has taken that love and he's ratcheted up another notch. Instead of calling you to return, the Lord returns to you. The same flesh and blood that returned to Jerusalem riding on a donkey. The same flesh and blood that went out from Jerusalem carrying a cross. The same flesh and blood that was buried outside Jerusalem. The same flesh and blood that came forth from that tomb alive. The same flesh and blood that ascended to the right hand of the Father and will come again in judgment on the last day. Dear friends, that same flesh and blood is available for you here tonight. The Lord has returned, and he offers himself to you. You see, you don't have to wait until judgment day to share in Christ's return. He returns to you this night with the same flesh and the same blood under the bread and wine. Take, eat, this is my body. Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sin. Tonight the Lord returns to you through this meal he has prepared. And so mercy is yours. Not because you have returned, but because the Lord returns to you. This is the fulfillment of the word of the Lord spoken by the prophet Zechariah. The Lord will again comfort Zion and again choose Jerusalem. O Jerusalem, bride of Christ, here is your comfort. Christ returns to you with his body and blood. He chooses you with passion, with jealousy. Here is the evidence, his body and his blood. Don't doubt it. Trust it. Believe it. And receive it. Amen. We rise. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us remain standing, and we will sing the last four verses of hymn 634.
Thank you.
We rise for prayer. We remember, Lord, that on this night in which you were betrayed, you provided the blessed meal of your Holy Supper for us. On the eve of the most dreadful hours of your life, we should think of what you were facing. But you did not think of yourself. You thought of us. You cared for us. And you remembered us so that we could remember often what you have done for our salvation. At this table, Lord, we join the whole company of believers who feast on your mercy. Unite us in the fellowship of faith as we are made one in this common meal. Make us participants in the victory which you won by the sacrifice of your body and blood. Seal to us the eternal fruits of salvation that you promised with the giving of this meal. May this Holy Supper always be to us the Holy Eucharist, the Holy giving of thanks, that we may find the joy which you provided for us by your sorrow. Accept now our thanks, Lord, and keep alive in us the hope that you shall break bread with us in eternity. This we ask as we now pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also, our Lord took the cup when he had supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated following the choir's selection of the hymns. Numbers are in your bulletin for our community hymns.
The table where the word of God is spoken. body of Christ.
Thank you.
with prayer of thanks. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup,
we give you, Lord, the Lord's death until you come.
We give you thanks, Eternal Father, for the very presence of your Son in this meal of forgiveness. By this sacrament, strengthen our faith, hope, and our love, that we may serve you with integrity and in peace. Through Jesus Christ, our light and life.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.